It's a great joy for me to be here and to speak to you. I was looking forward to meeting old friends and to make some new acquaintances. And my manuscript is way too long, so I cut it in half and give you just the last two sections of the paper. The first section is pretty theoretical, and the last section is more approachable, just to give you some hope. And I can build on many things Maureen just said, and therefore I can leave it out without too much uneasiness. In the refusal of the reception of one's being as a gift, no, I have to make a remark at first. The theme is the metaphysics of repetition or reenactment. And the basic idea is that Ulrich asks himself, from where can we criticize ideologies? And he says it can't be just another theory, but it must be a living act. And the living act is the reception of one's being as a gift of love. He is on common ground there with the Reformed theologian Karl Barth, who said, true teaching is an event. It's not a theory, but it's a living act. And Ulrich sees it the same way. And from there, the idea that you could criticize ideologies and repeat them on a different ground than they were produced. And so to take up the positive possibilities in these ideologies and to heal them. That's a very tricky business. It's close to hubris. So we have to see how he tries to do it. The first section is the logic of the brokenness of being. In the refusal of the reception of one's being as a gift, the esse as completum et simplex is substantialized and interpreted as a contradiction by which it's actually broken apart. All of us are confronted with such distorted receptions of being, and hence we are exposed to models showing being clinging to itself. The brokenness of being is a basic reality of the fallen world. We don't have to make it at first ourselves, because it's already there, not only as theories, but also as an experience. It distorts our view of God and weakens our freedom accordingly. That makes it difficult for us not to fall ourselves into a trap and to give in to the temptation of substantializing being. So we are victims and culprits of the brokenness of being ourselves. This makes it all the more important to understand what the brokenness of being does exactly do to us. When the esse completum et simplex et non subsistens is hypostasized and logicized, in ideality, being and essentia are separated, and God and human beings are closed up against each other. You see there already the brokenness. Since the esse is not yet given, the essence in its unity by itself seems to stem no longer from being. It becomes a realm apart from being. Ulrich speaks of the overemphasis of the non-causatum esse of ens in quantum ens over against the causatum esse, which threatens to destroy the reality of creation altogether. Quote Ulrich, in sum, when we hypostasize being in ideality and thus falsely absolutize it and accord it the intrinsic character of being uncaused, it implies an essence posited next to being. Similarly, the essence posited next to being implies the absoluteness of the uncaused character of being as being, and so a hidden negation of creation in general. So, esse and essentia are broken apart. But it goes even further. Since the essence no longer stems from being, even God himself seems to be affected by this. Quote Ulrich, therefore Thomas says that the essence is not a creature in God, but creatrix essentia, that is God himself. But if this were to lie next to being, and if being were isolated in the pseudo-subsistence, then the essence would lie in the divine intellect next to God as the other, in a possible essay which isolates itself more and more, separating itself from God until in the end it's no longer of God. In this respect, the essences that stand forth in the divine intellect accordingly provoke God to negate this negation, just as the ipsum esse has to negate the essence juxtaposed to it, so that the difference from the side of the finite and from the side of the infinite is interpreted as aspects of a single feature, namely the yet to be enacted self-mediation of being in its positivity and fullness. But this leads to a tremendous disempowerment of God the Father, who has yet to realize himself in order to unify esse and essentia in himself. The issue of ideas in God. Where do these ideas come from? What's the reality of these ideas? That's the issue here. Okay. The essence isolated from being leads to an overemphasis of res, of reality, over against ends, and hence opens up reality for the human ratio. Res, quiditas, materialis, and ends, which participates in esse, means it's the enclosure. Opens up reality for the human ratio in order to be taken over by human skills. The realm of possibilities in God seems to open up for the human ratio as well, which short circuits the absolute with the finite via the hypostasized esse. The materia is then no longer the good depth which carries the roots of finite beings, but it becomes the mere material for the collective building of the Tower of Babel. It's an image which is important for Ulrich. The ideality, as it is grasped in the realm of divine possibilities, is imprinted into the material realm of possibility and forms it into building bricks for the tower. Ulrich compares the plane on which the tower is built with the divine field of possibilities as the two sides of one single constellation. The ontological clamping of the absolute with the finite, what Maureen was talking about. The resultation of being from the principles of essence, forma, and materia is perverted in this way into the self-construction of the human world by humans who no longer want to receive themselves as a gift. The distorted ideality corresponds to the, quote Ulrich, intelligible knowledge kingdom of information, whereas, quote, closed, whereas the material realm in this context corresponds to the mere objectified corporality which can be manipulated at will. So you see how this gets concrete, you know, the divine possibility and materia as possibilities are taken over by humans and fused together and manipulated. Since human beings are in this brokenness of being seemingly no longer the gifts of a gracious God, they are also disempowered, and on the long run, they will be dissolved as free subject in such a worldview. In the end, they will be taken over again by the mother womb of the essence materia. By this brokenness, materia is also substantialized and becomes something very dangerous. This shows that we don't just deal with individual decisions here, but with matters of apocalyptic dimensions. Fortunately, we are in fact creatures of God. That means that the gift character of creation remains no matter what. It also means that in all brokenness of being, there always remains the structure of the gift character of being effective in beings, quote Ulrich. But the formal structure of the movement of finitization and its order as the theme of man's self-actualization is retained even in the most extreme perversion, according to the analogy of error, quote closed. Because of the fundamental structure of the finitization of being remains intact and operative in a determinative way, the aberration we observe does not occur randomly. It has its sustaining law, its metaphysical teleology, the formal structures of which hold sway in the error as its inner law. So ideologies have a certain logic, and this logic in the end follows the logic of the gift character of being. Quite interesting. Since a human being remains the gift of God and keeps his or her gift character, he or she has to try to put together again what is broken. Because this is not possible from the approach of logicizing, the human being oscillates back and forth between the broken elements in order to relate what belongs together. But the synthesis in our own power is not possible. Hence, the feeling of being torn apart accompanies us, and the broken elements are sought to be reunited again relentlessly. The omnipotence that thought presumes in thinking of being in the crisis unveils itself at the same time as being's impotence, its abandonment to the absolute essence, which is an essence that no longer receives being. But if being retains the formal structure of its mediation through essence, even in this perversion, then it cannot avoid attempting to come to itself through the non-receptive essence. It has to manipulate this dimension. This analysis of brokenness reminds of Kierkegaard's The Sickness Unto Death, which is perhaps familiar to you, so that you can, you know, imagine what I'm talking about. Necessity without possibility, the infinite without the finite, and so on. Kierkegaard described the consequences of sin as forms of brokenness and despair, which move along the intact form of human freedom. The formal structure connected to the finitization of being is described in Ulrich's book Leben in der Einheit von Leben und Tod. It is the structure of the unity between life and death as the gift character of being, which describes how the giver becomes present in his life, in his gift, meaning life, through the separation of the gift from the giver towards the receiver, meaning death. Death in the sense of giving away the gift, and meaning separation in a positive sense. It is of vital importance that this is an act of freedom, giving itself freely, umsonst, since the drive of the human being is in his or her brokenness is to restore this structure. It is almost impossible from the outside to differentiate estranged and healthy forms of freedom from each other. It's very important. Ulrich speaks in his probably most dense description of the estrangement of human freedom, Sprache der Begierde, Götzenwelt, reine Endlichkeit, of the formal Strukturgleichheit, equality of structure, of the two radically different unions of I, thou, and we. What is different, though, is the in-between, the atmosphere which determines the whole character and the quality of the constellation by either indicating a negative reification being at work, or the free umsonst of love. The equality of structure explains why people can remain for a long time under the spell of the lies of an ideology, even though this one produces inevitably disastrous results. It's the fruits which let us eventually recognize the nature of a worldview. And the equality of structure also explains why ideologies time and again have a strong religious component. If you think about the Parteitag of the Nazis in Nuremberg, how this is structured and, you know, how the whole event is organized, it's a religious event in the end. There are books about this theme. In order to lay out the difference between an understanding of being as love and the logicizing of being, Ulrich mentions the idea of Christ as the third between I and thou, tertius inter nos, which goes back to Allred from Rieval. Kierkegaard also spoke of God as the middle term between one person and another. It is God in the end who mediates the good relationship between persons, as Ulrich indicates in a graphic in Logotokos. Only the presence of the giver in you and me makes it possible that we relate well to each other, from freedom to freedom. But it's also this aspect of freedom which makes it difficult, at least at first, to grasp the difference between idols, meaning ideology, and expressions of true freedom. That's why Ulrich refers to the spirit as well as to the atmospheric, as it was described by the Japanese psychiatrist Bin Kimura, who has written a book about the importance of the in-between and the climate in Japanese culture. In order to indicate in which way we can grasp good and evil, that's why he speaks about the atmospheric and the spirit. We may not be able to differentiate between the forms of good and evil as structures in a clear-cut way, but we can still observe their fruits and smell the stench of evil and the odor of the good in a spiritual way. It's also a biblical theme. This is possible because we recognize by who we are ourselves through the spirit of the Father and the Son. Thomas Aquinas called it cognition by connaturalitatem. That's why, you know, the smell, the atmospheric, can be telling, because we recognize with our whole being. It's not just an intellectual thing. If the atmosphere of freedom is lacking, then this is a sign that the reification is at work, in which God and human beings, but also human beings among each other, are isolated against each other by the substantializing of esse. The other is then a closed substance standing against me, which I have to break up, the enemy who has to be conquered or appeased. The other is basically a thing with which I have to deal because he or she is no longer transparent to the giver of life, the absolute freedom. In this way, the refusal to receive one's being as a gift encloses us into a prison, because we become also for ourselves a mere thing which lacks the depth of freedom. And every attempt to gain free space over against others or myself from this position is only the putting up of another fence around my own prison. Doesn't work. I don't get out of myself in this way. This imprisoned I is the totalitarian I equals I. Homo incurvatus in se. The human being enclosed in him or herself. But at the same time, there exists in this I equals I the avidity for being one body with others and to be consumed by others in order to feel alive. Between the I equals I and the rest of reality exists the rule of devouring and of being devoured. This rule enables the isolated I equals I to cling to the illusion of being broken up and hence of being innocent. On the other hand, of being forced to rule over the rest of the world, of the refusing world. Yeah. This shows that the land of the idols is a realm of the violent sacrifice and of war, in which the appearance of genuine freedom must appear as a basic threat because it menaces to destroy the made-up enclosure of the I equals I. When I was in the military, the officers didn't like when we smiled, you know, in the back. Because it showed that we were thinking subjects and we had our own opinions. They hated it. That's just a little illustration what's meant with, you know, this showing up of freedom is very threatening to compulsory systems. All totalitarian atrocities throughout history stem from there. It also basically leads to people being treated like cattle or Menschenmaterial, human material, which is no longer named, but only marked and numbered. You find this idea even in Apocalypse 13, as an apocalyptic text, where you have to bear the number of the animal in order to be able to trade and make a living. The more genuine and innocent the freedom is, the more it risks, therefore, to become the target of the I equals I, who is driven by the lust for power. The diabolical is particularly keen on destroying the child, who is the role model for the human being receiving him or herself as a gift, and the uterus spiritualis, in which the child can grow up. This threat has by no means disappeared in our modern world. Last section, the reenactment as a healing process. What Ulrich offers us in his analysis of brokenness is basically the phenomenology of hell, because he describes the conditions of what Georges Bernanos defined as hell. Hell, madam, is not to love anymore. Hell is the absence of love, the refusal of love, the metaphysics of reenactment, which wants to go back to the roots of love in this realm of estrangement and brokenness, can only be a kind of philosophical discipleship in substitutionary atonement. The reenactment is in this way the crisis, the judgment of evil, and it is at the same time the healing of the broken. We do not judge by the condemnation of sinners, of also philosophical sinners. In this sense, it is said that we should not judge. But the light of love itself is the judgment because it simply uncovers by itself evil as such. Of Abba Sisos, it is told that he asked a student, "Tell me what you see in me, and I will tell you what I see in you," one of the church desert fathers. The student said, "You are noble in spirit, but a little bit harsh." And the and the old man said to him, "You are good, but you have a softish sense." The old man is just by being who he is a mirror for others because he keeps receiving his being as a gift. He's, so to speak, a living crisis of being. The metaphysics of reenactment in the fullest sense means that such a living crisis of being goes where things are broken and helps to receive one's freedom as a gift again, with all which that implies from others and, first of all, from God. Ulrich emphasizes that the liberation of the estranged freedom can only come from above, because the liberation cannot evolve simply from the state of estrangement itself. The change in thinking happens as a breakthrough to the light by acting the truth in the sense of aletheien en agape, being truthful in love, and only the breakdown of the whole evil constellation can set the imprisoned free. So the metaphysics of reenactment is a story of repentance and conversion, as Ulrich described it in his interpretation of the parable of the lost son in the volume Gabe und Vergebung. There the son squanders the heritage his father has given to him in a foreign country until he has nothing left and suffers from hunger. But since this heritage is the self-giving of the father, it cannot be exhausted in reality. In order to experience scarcity and hunger, the son has to make first the heritage to money. He has to treat the heritage according to the laws of idealization. Only then can he bring himself into the realm of suffering and hunger. But the heritage is still there, and it operates in the son to finally bring him back to the father. Because of the hidden presence of the father, the son is reminded of the father by grace through his hunger. The negative emptiness of deprivation opens up by grace the memory of the rich poverty of the reception of being, which helps to grow the urge to return to the father. The felt need lays bare the fact that he is still the son of the father who wants to live and participate in his origin. There's a Swiss songwriter, and I just tell it to you just for fun. He says, "Mangem, wo das Leben wehtut, besinnt sich der Tür wieder dran." Meaning, many who are hurt by life remember it, meaning life again by that. Missing the father means that there is something of the father present in him. In his being lost, mercy finds him there. In the middle, in his nothingness, the mystery of mercy sallies forth. Quote Ulrich. Because the son loves himself in the power of the same love that God shows towards him, he can now have mercy with himself and receive forgiveness. Reenactment means, in this context, the search for the pain expressed by a theory or a worldview, also of the hopes and the insights. It means really to listen to the other. It's important to be reminded that we ourselves are also having fears, doubts, and pains and hopes. In addition, we might not find our theoretical atheism in the writings standing for the logicizing of being, but our practical atheism, which is even worse. We are all in solidarity to each other, as can be seen in the mercy of the lost son, the mercy the lost son receives. The son who returns to the father is finally able to admit his guilt. His confession of guilt lives from grace. And since God in Christ atoned for all, the communion with him brings us into communion with all in a quality which corresponds to the depth of the atonement. What Christ has done for all, he has done for each and everyone, in particular to the full extent, which means that we cannot desolidarize ourselves from anyone by drawing lines where Christ didn't. Of course, that's pure theology, I know. But it also has consequences in dealing with ideologies in a philosophical way. But this solidarity is not an abstract one which would erase the individual guilt as such. Therefore, the believer can only understand himself in the poverty of the non-believer, as Ulrich emphasizes. This means that in the metaphysics of reenactment, we have to reckon with the reception of new insights and with a further liberation of ourselves by dealing with the logization of being we encounter in others. With this in mind, it's understandable that Thomas Aquinas said we should also be thankful toward those who err, in our view at least, because they also contribute in their own way to the search of truth. Ulrich also emphasizes that the metaphysics of reenactment can never dispose of the other. This has the consequence that the metaphysics of as reenactment is not a hermeneutics of suspicion. We have to remain open and we have to reckon with the operation of the Holy Spirit in places where we might not have expected it. Into the same chapter goes the often cited insight of Kierkegaard that love presupposes in the other what it wants to give, love. Ulrich's interpretation of the conversion of the lost son shows in what way this can be the case. All these points show that the metaphysics of reenactment does not want to replace the other or to patronize him or her. It puts itself in the miracle of empty hands, as Bernanos called it, at the disposal of the liberation of the other, knowing that everybody else, including myself, needs liberation too. Who does practice the metaphysics of reenactment moves with the other, learns from him or her, exposes himself to the fears, doubts, and pains of the other, and relates everything to the gift of being as love. That's the exact meaning of reenactment. We do it all again, but with the perspective to receive ourselves as gifts of God in everything. And then things and situations begin to speak to us and you in a dramatic and enlightening way. This is the secret of Chesterton's Father Brown, who solves crimes by committing them himself. A short passage from this little story. The secret is, he said, Father Brown, and then stopped as if unable to go on. Then he began again and said, "You see, it was I who killed all those people." "What?" repeated the other in a small voice out of a vast silence. "You see, I had murdered them all myself," explained Father Brown patiently. "So, of course, I knew how it was done." The healing effect of the metaphysics of reenactment is the achievement of a deep understanding which does justice to the most basic needs of human beings. Since it is more than a mere intellectual event, because the whole person is involved in it, due to being a cognition by connaturality, it establishes a resonance between persons that explains why it is not simply by chance that the Hebrew word yada not only signifies cognition, but also intercourse. Nothing is more intimate than to gain a new access to the source of love, which is love itself. The biblical scene which illustrates this in the most impressive way is the encounter of Jesus with a Samaritan woman at the wellspring of Jacob, where he offers her the Spirit of God. You have to see that the Song of Songs as a biblical background of this story explains what it actually means. It's the encounter between the Savior and humankind. Great story. I like it. In a chapter on cognition and love, Ulrich shows in Leben, in der Einheit von Leben und Tod, that true recognition is to enable the other, because in the recognition is my sympathy for you expressed. Erkennen means erkennen. Because true recognition is an act of love which serves the truth of the other. And the latter is not possible without the identification with the other as an act of giving, which also implies a specific passive inability. And Ulrich uses the word inability. I don't control the whole thing. Which leaves room for the other. From there, Ulrich makes the connection to the phenomenon of substitution, not replacement, in which one becomes the other in love. Thank you for your attention.